Now we have with us Mr. Ajay Prakash Sawhney. Mr. Sawhney was appointed as the Secretary to the Government of India, Ministry of Electronics and Information Technology. His work on national policy on electronics was a starting stone for electronics reforms in the sector. He has been vocal about right usage of social media channels in India. May I call upon Mr. Ajay Prakash Sawhney to kindly address this August gathering.
Respected Professor Christoph Stuckelberger, guests, distinguished guests and delegates. It's my privilege to be here today for this international conference on cyber law, cybercrime, and cybersecurity. I think it's wonderful to see the participation from so many countries, from so many fields, and so many distinguished people who have gathered here today. I would like to compliment Dr. Pavan Duggal and his team for having grown this conference year after year to such a magnitude, and having been able to get people from so many countries into India, into New Delhi, for discussion on these very, very important topics. I think we are all now fully a part of the World Wide Web. The internet is helping us lead lives in a very different way. Cyberspace is of increasing relevance to all of us. A lot of work, a lot of learning, a lot of activities that we used to do offline. I think now we call it offline because now there is also an online avatar of that. And it is helping us, but also bringing a number of new threats into our space. Cyberspace has very distinct and unique characteristics as compared to physical space. It is virtual, it is borderless. The anonymity it offers, I think, encourages people to do things that they would probably not venture to do in physical space. Cyber attacks can be launched from anywhere in the world. There is limited possibility of tracing back and positively attributing these to a particular, to the attacker. Once someone is on the net, he can access any system on the net spread across the globe. Cyberspace offers a virtual environment where anyone can try to hide his identity, create a pseudonym, acquire a different or a false identity. Under these circumstances, the security of computer infrastructure acquires tremendous significance. We have seen security breaches happening, which sometimes take days, months, or years to detect. There must be many which pass by undetected. A large number of new malware apps are emerging. Every day we see a large number of new apps emerge. On top of that, I think we are now living a part of our lives on the social media. Looking up Facebook, seeing what is coming on WhatsApp, I think screen time has become a very large part of our lives today. All kinds of content gets posted. Anyone can post. It's instantly available. It's instantly shared. Content goes viral in no time. And sometimes, the content which is posted even inadvertently and sometimes mischievously or maliciously, goes viral, and it's very difficult to contain. In India, we have been witnessing a steep surge in the use of social media platforms. Many of the prominent platforms across the globe now count India as the largest user base for such platforms. Even though internet is seriously used only by about 500 million people in India, and 800 million people are yet to be covered, even then, India still accounts for almost the largest user base in many of these platforms. So while there have been tremendous benefits, tremendous empowerment which these platforms have brought in, they have also brought in a number of challenges. Straight away, they pose a dilemma. Where does, we believe in freedom of speech. We believe in certain values. To what extent can people use or, infringe those when they actually get on to the social media? We need to ensure, and we have seen this happening, so we need to ensure that the platforms do not become vehicles to commit crime, to incite hatred, to provoke terrorism or extremism, to promote or execute money laundering activities, and various other activities which infringe our laws and our way of life. Recently, the term fake news has gained tremendous importance. It is a type of yellow journalism or propaganda which consists of deliberate misinformation, hoax information which is spread wide using online social media. Fake news is typically written and published with the intent to mislead. It is written in order to damage an agency or an entity or a person, gain wrongfully in financial, political, or various other manners, create disturbance, create unrest, sometimes using sensational, dishonest, or outright fabricated headlines which attract readers, which encourage people to simply share that content and improve the internet click revenue. Typical attributes of fake news are that it spreads very fast, it is doctored, it is incorrect, it is malified, it is intentional, sensational, glamorous, is unverified. And the problem is that it goes viral. It wouldn't be a problem if it were to sort of get contained and stay limited in its reach. But social media suddenly provides us the ability, and many a time it is the malicious or fake content which goes viral rather than something which is very beneficial. With the execution of, with looking at all of this, in India we have also seen a number of instances which attracted tremendous public attention. Sometimes news, fake news or misinformation that was spread resulted in commitment of crime, serious crime. There were some cases of lynching as well, going by, some rumors that get spread rapidly. And the government has been very cognizant of this issue. Our Honorable Minister had made certain statements in the Parliament, and I would like to mention that social media service providers in India are regulated as online intermediaries. They are expected to ensure that they comply with in the IT Act as well as all other applicable laws. To get immunity from, being directly responsible for what gets carried, because it's content which other people post, so these are intermediaries. But they need to exercise due diligence to ensure that the laws of the country are not infringed. Our Honorable Minister had also assured the Parliament that the legal framework would be strengthened to ensure that significant social media and instant messaging service providers, which are targeting Indian users, do not deprive Indian users of the right to bring proceedings in India and to enjoy the protection of Indian law. They are also required to appoint grievance officers for redressal of complaints, and we have been asking all the social media platforms to try to have an active and responsive system within India so that any issues that Indian citizens or Indian users raise get addressed with due seriousness. Now, in the recent period, we are also seeing tremendous emergence of new technologies. In India, India is seen as a huge source of very rich and diverse data. Our Aadhaar platform has grown to 1.22 billion people. Mobile usage has gone to 1.21 billion connections in the country. These are enormous numbers. The GSTN network is implementation of GSTN across the country has created a platform which now brings in huge amount of data day in and day out. Systems which are using Aadhaar contribute a huge amount of data. There are about 30 million instances, 30 million authentications that happen every day on the Aadhaar system. The UPI platform, UPI is the Unified Payments Interface or the Bharat Interface for Money. The UPI platform has been growing exponentially. I was just recently looking at the data. It's a platform which is growing 10 times every year today. Last 2 years, from 4 lakh to 40 lakh, or which is 400,000 to 4 million, we were able to reach in about 7 to 8 months. After that, from 4 million to 40 million, another about 11 months. And once again, in another 11 months, we have reached more than 400 million transactions per month. And this happened in September, and 482 million transactions in the month of October. So it is growing extremely rapidly. Now, all of these platforms basically generate humongous amount of data. Data is considered the new oil. Data is considered something of tremendous value, especially when the techniques of data analytics, machine learning, deep learning, all of these get used, we can draw tremendous inferences, we can create new solutions that to problems that have remained, that have eluded us, eluded solution for many, many generations. Now, with this huge amount of data getting generated, there have also been concerns about data privacy. There have been concerns in India which were expressed. We have seen the Supreme Court in India come out with a determination that privacy or data privacy is a fundamental right in India. It emanates from fundamental rights. We have seen a determination which indicates in what manner, in the context of Aadhaar, how Aadhaar can be used, what are the limitations. And in many senses, the judgment which has come recently indicates to us how data should be used in a very responsible manner. And it has also created a responsibility on the government to bring in a legal framework that duly provides protection of the Indian law to Indian citizens and to the data privacy of Indian citizens. We have seen similar efforts take shape elsewhere in the globe. The GDPR, or the General Data Protection Regulation, has been brought into implementation from May, and we have seen California, the state of California in the US, come out with a Consumer Protection Act sometime during this year, in the last few months. In India also, we are engaged in this process, and a committee headed by Justice Sri Krishna had given its report and a draft framework for data protection to us on 31st of July this year. Currently, we are going through a process of consultation, and very shortly, we hope to bring this to the cabinet and to the parliament to bring in a robust framework for personal data protection in India. I think as the new threats grow, we need to have conferences like this, engage in a large amount of discussion. Each of the new technologies brings in new opportunities, they bring in new challenges. There is an opportunity today to be able to solve problems which have eluded solutions for generations, for millennia. We can find new solutions in health, we can find new solutions in education, we can find new solutions in taking services to every single person on the earth. We can solve issues of poverty, we can solve issues of non-availability of energy. All of these need very responsible use of technology. With the responsible use of technology, there will also be huge and humongous, ever-growing challenges in cybersecurity, challenges in making sure that growth doesn't happen without equity. I'm sure that a conference of this magnitude, with such distinguished people participating in it, will go a long way in helping us understand the issues, understand where we are, what are the best practices that are emerging from across the globe, and take us forward in a healthy and positive direction where we do not have to shun technology. We can embrace technology, we can make use of technology very confidently, and ensure that the benefits of technology reach each and every person on the globe. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Sawhney, for your remarkable, powerful comments.